Good morning, Warren Church of Christ. Hey, we're so thankful that you guys all came to worship with us today. We have a little something special in planned for today. Mickey is sick, and Andrew just got back from missions trip, so it's a little short notice for him to prepare a sermon. So instead, all of these wonderful students and adults who got to go on the missions trip to Manchester, Kentucky, are going to be talking about not only what they did, but what they learned, what insights they gained, what aha moments they had, and also as they were working, they also did an entire study through the book of James, and so they're going to be sharing what they learned from that. So that's going to be a really fun, something different for us to do today. Would you all just start our worship service with me with prayer? Let's all go to the Lord. Father God, we are so thankful to be able to worship here today, that the church is open, that even though plans aren't quite exactly what we had thought we were going to do a week ago, that your grace is sufficient, Lord, and that this is going to be an awesome day of sharing and learning together. We ask that you are with all of those who are gathered today and those who are listening online and who will listen later down the road. We know that each of us comes today with joys, but also with sadness and burdens, that we all have things that we're struggling with. God, I pray that you are near to our hearts and that you would help us to grow through whatever circumstance we're in. We ask that you would be present with us here today and help us all to worship you in spirit and truth. We ask this in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen.
Please stand and join us.
Shadows. belong to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. You called my name, and I ran out of the grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
I needed rescue, my sin was heavy, but chains break.
You called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Now your mercy has saved my soul. can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He is roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him.
Sing
of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Amen. He is so good. And while we prepare to recognize that he is so good, please come to a communion table, return to your seat, and we will observe that together.
Let's have a show of hands. No. Thank you, Roger. Who sinned this week? I don't see. I assume everybody probably did something. Troy, this isn't for you. You didn't raise your hand. It's fine. It's amazing when you dig into the word what you find, and looking for something to say today, I came across this not in just one but two different places, so I thought maybe I better share it. It's about our motives and how easily it is that we can sin and not even know it, and why we need Jesus and his sacrifice. It says, when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. Imagine being on the mountainside as Jesus amazed the people with his words. He didn't simply recite Old Testament law as the scribes and Pharisees did. He provided God-ordained insight. For example, he said, you have heard that it was said, you shall not murder. But I tell you that anyone who is angry with his brother or sister will be subject to judgment. That one kind of hits home with me, mainly when I'm driving, because I feel like I'm better than everybody else, especially the guy in front of me. And a lot of times it's the guy that's driving from the truck stop to Warren. That speed limit does go up to 55. You don't have to drive 40 all the way to Warren. Jesus also said that you have heard it said, you shall not commit adultery. But I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. He also said that you have heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, also love your enemies. No other rabbi spoke with such authority. People were amazed that Jesus provided insight into the true nature of sin. The action of sin isn't only the problem that humans must deal with. It's the motive or the thought, the conception of sin, with which we also must deal. How do we deal with this? Amazingly, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us, Romans 5:8. Jesus, who had no sin problem, suffered the penalty for us who do. We deal with our sin by placing our trust in the one who conquered it. Because of Jesus' death, we have a solution for our self-gratification, self-indulgence, and every other self-focused motive that results in sin. Centuries and centuries later, we are amazed at Jesus, not only by his words, but by his love that moved him to sacrifice himself on a cross. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, we thank you so much for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for our sin, because without him, we would have no way to heaven. We know that we ourselves are not good enough. We never could be. And that without him, there would be no path for us to spend eternity with you. So, dear Lord, we take these next few moments and thank you for the sacrifice of your Son and for the forgiveness of our sins. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. He took the bread and said, "Take and eat. This is my body." And then he took the cup and said, "This is my blood of the covenant." Will you pray with me once more? Dear Lord, we thank you for everything that you have given us. And right now we just take a moment to pray for the offerings and the gifts that the church receives. And we just pray that we could continue to pour out those gifts among the community and among the world as we just hope to draw as many people as we can to you. We thank you for everything. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
All right, so it's the prayer and praise time portion of our service. And before we get into the prayers, I have a couple of announcements. As you can see, we need candy for our Salamone Summer Festival float this year. And if you would like to donate candy, I think there's a box out there by the new window. Or you can also see Liz if you have any questions with that. And we also need some snack cake donations for a game that we're going to be hosting for this summer festival. We also need a few volunteers, and there's a sign-up sheet over there at the sign-up table. So if you'd like to do that, you can either sign up or come and see me or come and see Liz. Now we have some prayer requests. Please pray for Shirley Muncy. She is recovering from surgery at Bluffton Regional. Continue to pray for Amy Sturma, who has continuing health problems. Pray for Nikki Swoverland, who is hospitalized with intestinal cancer. And as Liz mentioned at the beginning of the service, please keep the Strong family in your prayers. They all have COVID, and then they're going to be leaving, hopefully on Saturday, for their vacation, and they'll be gone for a couple of Sundays. So just pray that they will be able to leave and just go to Florida and have fun. And I got a new one today from Sarah Wright. This is for Teresa Wright. She has cancer, and she's going to be starting chemo soon. She had an 11-hour surgery to remove as much of the cancer as they could, and they nicked an artery, and she lost function of one of her kidneys. So if you would continue to pray for her. And then also, we would like to extend our sympathy to Becky Hartley and her family with the passing of her dad this week. The funeral will be today at 2 p.m. at Arms and Hunt Funeral Home in Marion. So will you pray with me? Father God, I thank you for this day. And I just thank you that we can all just gather together and worship you. And I pray that you would be with all of the requests that were mentioned today. I pray that you would be with all of those people. Just continue to heal them, help them to feel better. We also pray for the Hartley family as they are mourning the loss of a dad, grandpa, father-in-law. We just pray that you would just be with them today as they will lay him to rest. We just, again, thank you for everything. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right. So I'm just going to stay up here because, as you can see, we all have these. There's people up here in the front row that have these nice blue shirts on. So we just got back from our mission trip last night or yesterday at like, what was it, like 3:30? It was a really, really awesome week, really intense week. But we all had a lot of fun. We grew as a team, and we also Just got to just spend some time with Jesus this week. It was really cool. So I'm going to just kind of give an overview of what we did, and then all of our students and our sponsors that went are going to tell you guys a little bit more about what happened. So our mission for the week is, I actually found out the day before we left what we were going to do. So we helped out at this small Christian camp called Possum Trot Christian Camp. You know you're in Kentucky when something is called Possum Trot, right? So we didn't really know what to expect. The first day we went up to the main camp part, which is on the top of this hill. And it's covered by trees. And so the guy, his name is Mike, he was like, so you guys today are going to be raking leaves, trimming weeds, and just kind of cleaning up the camp. We're like, okay, that's not a big deal, right? We're all like, this is going to be okay. And so we're cutting weeds, raking leaves, and I am back by one of the outhouses trimming, and I see this snake. Okay, it was like this big, and I had nicked it with the weed eater and killed it. And then a little bit later, we were picking up leaves. We see these wolf spiders, no kidding, are this big around. And all the kids are like, whoa, those are cool. Some of them didn't really want to see them. We saw two of those, and then we saw another snake. So we're like, well, do we really want to keep doing this or not? We did it. We went back. We came back. Excuse me. Came back the next day, and we've set up a big tent, like what you would see at the summer festival. And so the next couple of days, we were tasked with building picnic tables. So we built two picnic tables in 2 days, and they were the sturdiest picnic tables that, this is no joke, this is what the guy said. He's like, these are the sturdiest picnic tables we have ever built here at this camp. And he told us that there was one group that was like last year or something. It took them 1 week to build one picnic table. We did 2 in 2 days. So that's really cool that we all worked together. And then we also, these shirts, we put on a VBS for the local kids at a local park. So we had to compete with, there was a pavilion, but we had to compete with a splash pad. So the first day we had, what, like 4 kids? Next day we had like 10. And then the last day we had probably 5 or 6. So it fluctuated, but like I said, we had to compete with this splash pad. The splash pad is like in our ears, making noise. The kids are screaming, having fun. We're trying to go over and get them. They're like, we don't want to leave the water, right? So yeah, it was a really cool opportunity to go and just serve the people of Manchester, Kentucky. It was kind of a culture shock for us, I think. It was so different from, it was a town that was the same size as Warren, but major, major culture shift. So with that, we're going to start. Oh yeah, Misty is going to come up and kind of, I was going to get there. Misty is going to come up and kind of give you guys a brief overview of the organization leader treks that we went through.
Thank you. So Leader Treks is an organization out, they are based in Illinois. They were founded in 1994. This is an organization that I was unfamiliar with until Andrew saw out and found a youth ministry retreat for him to attend. And that is how we got involved with Leader Treks. The founder, Doug Franklin, saw a need for the development of leaders and leadership in young people in the church. He saw them not getting chances to lead, and I myself am very guilty of this, and I found out exactly how I was guilty of that on this trip, and I'll share a little bit about that. I just want to share a little bit about what Leader Treks believes about youth ministry. They believe that youth ministry is the ministry of students to the world. They believe that we must shift from having churches with ministries to students to having students with ministries to their world, is what they mean by that. And we saw that walked out here on this mission trip that we took this last week through the kids. They designed the entire VBS program that we did, 2 hours worth of a program every day for 3 days straight. They designed that by themselves. They did, they created a music time. They came up with the songs, motions, to teach the kids. They came up with the stories that would be taught to them. They taught, I believe, I'll let them tell you about who they taught about in the Bible and the stories that they shared with the kids. But another value that Leader Treks has about youth ministry is that youth workers need to be the leaders. So the kids needed to be the leaders on this trip. And as I referenced a minute ago, that is how I came to know how terrible I was at leading. Leading is not just, Leader Treks taught us that leading is not just leading by example. Massive part of it, of course, and that's what we do, and that's what we here at Warren Church of Christ, I believe, are very good at, is leading by example. However, when you are standing in a kitchen to make and serve food to the 14 people on the missions trip with you, you as a mom and as somebody who's prepared food for 14 years for a small group know how to make enough taco meat for 14 people. You know exactly what to do. I'm getting out that skillet. I'm getting out the ground beef. The students did not. I had to literally sit on my hands and let them do it because one of the objectives of Leader Treks is that students learn the most about leadership when they themselves do it. And that includes success, of course, and failure. And so one of the things that I appreciated most about this trip was that every time the students had a leadership opportunity, every morning for breakfast, every night for dinner, at the camp and at VBS, they were asked to evaluate themselves and what went well, what could have gone better. And that was a crucial part of our trip, to have to evaluate that over and over. They believe that evaluation is an essential ingredient for growth. So honest examination of the leader's performance will continue the process of development, of leadership development in their lives. Another thing that Leader Treks is passionate about is while that parents are the primary faith influencers. And so they spent just as much time working with us as leaders, as youth leaders, to pour into students, as they did with the students as well, parents and youth workers. And another point that they made is that students can lead now. It doesn't have to, they don't have to wait. And some of them were uncomfortable with that on our trip. And so part of their trip is an adventure day. You will see pictures of that adventure day. And I kind of made a joke that there, with this very rough trail that we hiked together as a group, there was weeping and gnashing of teeth, but we pushed. Everybody pushed each other, myself included. I needed pushed. I was bringing up the rear in the back of the line, showed up mightily by the teenagers that were along with us on the trip. But again, I want to reiterate how impactful this trip was on us as leadership because of that very premise that these students have to be the ones to lead. They have to be the ones to fail. They have to be the ones to figure out that when you started out that French toast, it wasn't working. They have to be the ones to learn to lead and to be uncomfortable, because that's what it takes for the next time for them to be just comfortable enough to take the next step in leadership. So with that, I'd like to invite our, will this be our first student sharing on James 1? Oh, wonderful. With that, I would like to, we want to share with you some of the music that was some of, was part of the basis for our missions trip this week for VBS.
Okay, so during VBS, we had three songs that we did, and our main song that we did was called King of Me by Ring Collective. So here's how it goes.
My friend King Dave wouldn't let the giant stand in his way. He said, hand me my sling, cause he's not that tall. My God is bigger and I watch him fall. My God's the king of the giants. My God's the king of the lions. My God's the king of the creatures of the deep. My God's the king of me. Have you heard the one about this guy called Dan? Yes, he was a mighty holy praying man. They said, throw him to the den of the scary beast. But God saved a hero from the lion's teeth. Yeah! My God's the king of the giants. My God's the king of the lions. My God's the king of the creatures of the deep. My God's the king of me. Jonah and the whale at sea. When I'm lost and afraid, all alone in the dark, you're with me. Oh, you're with me. My God's the king of the giants. My God's the king of the lions. My God's the king of the creatures of the deep. My God's the king of me. My God's the king of the giants. My God's the king of the lions. My God's the king of the creatures of the deep. The king of me.
Okay, so throughout the week we covered the book of James. We did the first four chapters of James, and then I don't know who all did, but on the bus ride home, on the 5-hour bus ride, I went ahead and did James 5 to finish it out. But on Monday and Tuesday, we started with James 1, so I'm going to talk about that. And then after I talk about that, I'm going to talk about my experience on the missions trip. So James 1, the first day, what we read really talked about trials and how trials help us come closer to the Lord. And we need to realize that and not let our trials get in our way. And on that day, the verse that really stuck out to, I think, basically the whole youth group and everyone there was James 2. And that says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. And so I took that really to heart because in the past couple of years, I know I've had a lot of trials. So it really showed me that my trials meant something and that they helped me get closer in my faith. And then on the second day, if I can find it. Yes, on the second day, the one that it talked about is a lot about like sins to avoid, and it talked about a lot about being slow to anger. And so the one I think the verse that stuck out to a lot of us was James 1:19, my dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. And so we talked a lot about becoming angry and how to deal with that anger properly before it gets too far and you end up hurting someone. So then one of the biggest impacts when I was there was Brooke and I were in charge of the story time at the VBS. And if you couldn't tell from the song, we talked about David and then Daniel and then about Jonah and the whale. But on the second day, I was teaching about Daniel in the lion's den. And the kids were just sitting there staring at me, like, intensely. Like, they wanted to hear what I was saying. And one girl just kept saying the phrase, it's okay because God is always with us. And our theme for our VBS was God is always with us. And so that really spoke to me. And it really showed me that sharing my faith can have an impact on people. Whether that's someone that already knows God or someone that's never been introduced to God. And it really showed me that my faith means something to other people. And then when we were on our hike, Eli, which was one of our group leaders from Leader Treks, pulled me aside and said that he hoped that in a couple years I would really consider signing up to do something with Leader Treks as a leader. And he hadn't known me for but like 5 days, I think, something like that. And just that he could see that he thinks that I should do something like that really had a big impact on me. And then I think Jackson is next to talk about James 2.
How many of you have shown favoritism? Raise your hand. One time, yep. Next slide. James 2:2-4 says, suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and a fine clothes, and a poor man in filthy clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, here's a good seat for you, but say to the poor man, you stand there or sit on the floor by my feet. I think this is a perfect example of favoritism because it's showing like what favoritism is. And then James chapter 2:4 says, have you not discriminated yourselves among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Because we all need to treat everyone the same. And so what we had every day, or Monday through Friday, we had team time where, as you can see a picture up here, on when we did James chapter 2, we did the OPA method. And the A stands for application. For my application, I put, before you are talking to multiple people, you need to stop and think how to treat them equally. And then also in James 2:15-17 says, suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well-fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself is not accompanied by action is dead. So you need to have faith and deeds, otherwise you're nothing. And then I think we're going to have Caitlin talk about James 3.
Okay, so I did James chapter 3, and the reason why I did James chapter 3 was because it was on, like, taming the tongue, and if you know me, you know I don't filter when I talk, and so I just, like, I really felt God speaking to me when I read this chapter, and then my other reason why I picked it was because And I think the first verse of this chapter, it mentions something about, like, wisdom, what you're teaching. And, like, at first I was confused because I didn't understand the connection between, like, wisdom and, like, choosing your words wisely. And so I was thinking about it this morning, and I was like, well, I came up with three reasons to me, like, why you would need wisdom when you speak. And, like, the first one, like, you hurt people sometimes with, like, the words you say. So, like, you know, just be careful with that. And then the second reason is, like, you don't know what you're going to tell people that they might take out and tell other people that you don't want other people to know. And then, like, the third reason, and the, like, to me the most important, is that God holds you accountable for every word that you say. And so, yeah, that's why it was important to me. But, and I think we have Brooke next.
Okay, so I chose James chapter 4, and I really liked this chapter because it was all about submitting yourself to God. And one of the verses that I really liked was, "What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You do not have because you do not ask with God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with the wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. Friendship with the world means an enemy with God. Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God." But I know when you hear that verse, it's pretty powerful, and you really don't want to be associated with the world. But after that, he says, "But he gives us more grace." That's why Scripture says, "God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble." Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. So I really liked this verse because it was about submitting to God and being honest when you're full of sin. Because I know when we're full of sin, we still want to tell ourselves, "I'm okay, and I'm going to get through this on my own." But he says right here, "Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom." So be honest with your feelings, and he can forgive you for that. And it also says, "Brothers and sisters, do not slander one another. Who are you to judge your neighbor?" The last verse that I really liked was, "Why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that will appear for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, 'If it is the Lord's will, we will live this or do this or that.'" So just always ask if it's the Lord's will. I really liked the VBS this week. I taught the story of Jonah and Daniel in the lion's den. Oh, David and the Goliath. So that was really cool to see those kids, especially because I work at Boys and Girls Club. So I really like being around those kids, and I'm really glad I had this experience. So, who's next? You also?
Hello, everyone. I'm going to tell you about all of the things that we did at the work site for the missions trip. Like Andrew said earlier, we did a lot of yard working things, and we built two picnic tables, but we also did some painting in the boys' bathroom there, and it was kind of creepy going into the back because there were no lights at the start. We didn't know where the lights were. I did not like doing that, but I did it, and it was probably my favorite part of that because I like to paint. And I also thought it was pretty cool the way I did the saw and how everyone else got to build the tables too. I saw everyone grow in confidence, and it was so cool to be there, even if on my first night I was really scared and concerned about continuing to go. And I'm really excited to, I guess, for all of you to see all the different pictures here, because because they're very funny. Also, one other thing, we found a spider in the girls' bathroom sink, and we took a picture with it because we could. Who's next? Okay. Now I'll hand it off to Ella.
Okay, so something I want to talk about that I found really neat this week is just the growth in our group. So if you know me, you know that I'm a very introverted person. And this week, I was able to step out of that and better get to know people and build relationships with Brooke and Abigail and a deeper relationship with Elsa. And I got to know Jackson and Evan a lot better. And it was really neat just to be able to see people like Lily, who just took a lot of risks this week, and Caitlin, who took a lot of the risks this week. You know, seeing Brooke and Abigail step up in leadership and just all of us grow so much, whether it was as a group or individually. And so that's just something that I thought was super neat about this week. So I just want to thank each and every one of you who have prayed for us for this past week and who have given money so that way we have the opportunity to go on this trip, because each and every one of us has been blessed by this trip. And so I just sincerely thank you for that opportunity.
Okay, so I'm going to be talking a little bit more about the VBS. Like, Andrew already talked a little bit about it, but so what we did, like our VBS here at Warren Church of Christ, or with the at the other churches for Warren, WAMA, we had stations, and well, we didn't have very many kids, but we each had them go to the station. It was crafts first. Well, we started off with singing the song and telling them the memory verse, and then we went to crafts, and then we went to story time, and then we went to games, and then snacks, and then we did our songs again, and then again our memory verses, and then, well, I don't even know what I was gonna say, but there was different kids that came every single day. There was some that came every single day, some that came different days. But it was cool because you got to see them grow themselves, not just us, but them. Because like one of the girls during story time, I think Abigail said something about if you were in the whale, if you were Jonah in the whale or something like that, if you would be scared or something. And then one little girl said, I'm not going to be scared because God is always with me. And I thought that was really cool. And also, just one more thing. So the stories we talked about were the first day, which was Tuesday, we started off with David and Goliath. And then the second day, Wednesday, we talked about Daniel in the lion's den. And then the third day, we talked about Jonah and the whale. So, and then Evan, your turn.
Hello, I'm Evan, and I'm going to be a freshman next school year. On the mission trip in Kentucky, I saw God working in my life throughout the trip in the area of service, and I now feel like I have a much stronger will to serve in this church, in and around Warren, and I really feel like the mission trip helped me grow that way. My favorite part of the missions trip was running the VBS, because I really loved seeing all of the kids have tons of fun and learn all the things that we were teaching them about David and Goliath, Daniel in the lion's den, and Jonah and the whale. A specific moment in that was when I saw all of the kids on day three doing the motions and singing the song, and I thought that was really cool. On the trip, our trip leaders had a system for encouraging one another because of how big that is in being leaders. At the end of each day, each of us could give one other person in our group a bead. Red was leadership, blue was risk-taking, green was compassion, and white was service. And at the end of what we called team time, which was basically a team meeting, we would give each other the beads, and then we would, it was just really cool to see how everybody grew during the trip.
All right, so kind of what Evan had just said about the beads, us adults, we each had two kids on our team specifically for the kitchens, prep stuff, so that's kind of how we're going to talk, and we're going to kind of do it based off of the beads a little bit, or just kind of see how we saw God working in the lives of our little group amongst the big group. And so my two people were Lily and Brooke on my team. And Lily, I saw God working in your life through leadership, stepping into roles where you were challenged to lead your group and making meals. And while you were doing it, you were being challenged and questioned as to, you know, why are you doing this or why are you doing that? And sometimes it was overwhelming, but you did it and you overcame it. And you're going to keep growing. That was just the baby step of leadership in this group. And I can see, especially with your parents being in leadership roles here at the church, that you're going to keep growing in leadership. You did a lot of risk-taking. It's kind of between you and Caitlin, the risk-taking beads of the how many people, how many beads you had in risk-taking. But when you spoke, you learned to take risk in speaking, or even take risk in keeping our you know, being a little bit quiet when we're supposed to be quiet and speaking, or being asked for other people to have opportunities. So that was a risk, right? Man, the saw. I got to be there as you guys saw people sawing the boards. She was like, I'm not going to do it. I don't want to do it. And with talking with me and Travis and Nicole that were over in that, and Andrew in that area, she, within 5 minutes, was over there sawing. It took her a few attempts. She, you know, Pat tried it out, but she overcame and she did it, and it was super awesome to see her do that. And painting, she was, like she said, she was scared to go in the corner a little bit, but she painted and rocked it. She climbed and hiked to the natural bridge. She was so nervous. She was so challenged because she's not a huge fan of that extreme, right, of a hike, you said. But with lots of encouragements, and I was able to have the opportunity to hang out with you and work you through that, and how we talked at the saw and in the kitchen, and there we, and from Mickey's message I referenced, where he talked about breathing in God and breathing out God when we are maybe struggling. And so I want you to keep in mind of breathing in God and breathing out God when we need to, when we hit a challenge and need to get through that. But you rocked it. You got to top that bridge. And what happened? You loved it, right? You were so, so thankful. And your teammates were all there encouraging you along the way and even let you lead to the very end, which was super cool. And you overcame it. And I really pray that as you hit challenges throughout life, you think of that time and this whole week where you hit all these challenges. You're nervous, but who helps you get through it? Not just your teammates, but God was encouraging you and strengthening you through it. You had compassion and helping and service, kind of compassion and service here, being helpful to the children at your craft table, helping them out, serving them, loving them, and just serving and loving your team throughout the week. And I can see that you're going to keep growing in the service when you hit challenges. It kind of all goes together a little bit. But you're going to do awesome and just keep it up. So just remember to breathe in God, breathe out God. Brooke. I didn't really know you much before, and I'm still going to get to know you more, and I'm super excited about that. Man, leadership comes naturally to you. I saw God working through you is what I should say first, right? But you helped lead worship. You helped at night. You stepped up with Ella and sang. You guys sat and took extra time and practice in doing that, which was so awesome to see. You led in VBS. You helped do story time, and in the kitchen you helped lead, and on the site, you stepped up constantly to lead and step into places where just naturally, it was natural. As you said, you work with boys and girls, that leadership comes naturally to you. Risk-taking, you allowed yourself to be questioned with hard, intentional. One of the things that they encourage in LeaderTrex is to have intentional conversations with people. Get to know them, but have intentional conversations, intentional faith conversations, asking them how they can grow. And Travis, our team leader of LeaderTrex, he was drooling. And I was walking out after getting ready for the evening and just saw her getting drilled. And, you know, she was answering, but kept being asked questions. And she was so brave, allowed an adult to help her, and we got to talk about it and got to overcome that. And I read the scripture to you. Sorry, I want to read it right here. 2 Corinthians chapter 12:9. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses and insults and hardships and persecutions and difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. And that is only through Christ. And so when you, when you took a risk in asking an adult for help, in seeking out that help, you took risk. I mean, even just through the week with other things, but that to me stood out. So, you know, as you go through college and you're going through your senior year and all this, like, just seek out all these adults in here, you know, seek out and seek Christ in the Word. And then in compassion, you showed so much love to your team and group, which is coming naturally. And you loved so many people. You loved your teammate. You encouraged when they were needing encouragement. You knew exactly what to say. And it was like a little mini adult in there. And I mean, you're only coming into a senior year, and I'm like, she's so much mature than I ever was at that age. And just being able to breathe words of encouragement and just love towards her, all of her team, towards the kids at VBS. And then in service, same thing, natural born leader. You're just always jumping in, doing everything that you need. And I just see you going so far, and I just pray that you keep seeking God's will. And whatever that will is, I know that you will be there to serve God and serve him through everything. That was great. Okay.
The two youth that served on my team were Abigail and Jackson. Abigail, I saw God working in Abigail's life this week through leadership. Leading prep time in the kitchen, she naturally stepped into a leadership role, understanding how to delegate yet serve with compassion. During cleanup, her ability to lead was demonstrated as she promptly was able to communicate the jobs needing to be completed without having to wait for Eli or Travis to ask, okay, guys, what needs to be done? She demonstrated leadership on Friday morning when we were waiting for Travis to arrive for breakfast meal prep. She was in charge of the group and already had a course of action communicated with Jackson and myself before Travis arrived. She did not waste her time while waiting for him on idle conversation. She was ready to help us through leadership to make a successful breakfast. I also saw God working in Abigail's life through leadership several times throughout the week. Abigail offered her help to the group. She specifically offered several times to help Caitlin or myself out. Whatever it was, helping to prepare a plate for Caitlin or offering to carry a shower chair or supplies, she was willing to help. At the worksite, Abigail demonstrated her leadership skills through quickly noticing in inefficient situations, such as cleaning the paint rollers, and offering suggestions or reminders to the team on how to perform or complete a task. Abigail, your leadership stuck out to me the most because I often heard you say, "Hey guys," or "Hey whoever you were talking to, what about this?" or "What can I help you with?" or "Can I show you how to do that?" which is also showing compassion. Your ability to lead was wrapped in compassion and the desire to serve. I didn't hear you put people down, but rather I heard you encourage your teammates when offering suggestions or trying to redirect situations. Abigail, as you're preparing to leave this week for FFA, your leadership skills will serve you well. I want to encourage you with Proverbs 3:27 that says, "Do not withhold good from those who deserve it when it is in your power to act." And I didn't know Abigail very well before this trip, but she possesses so many qualities. She's not afraid to take a risk. She's not afraid to step up and lead. She's compassionate when she does it. And I just want to encourage you that no matter what you do in life, do that for the glory of God. And thankful for the time I got to serve with you this week. Jackson, I saw God working in Jackson's life this week through service. I told Shanna, I think because Abigail's a little bit older, it was easy to pick out that skill or that trait that she had. Jackson's younger, and so I think he's developing those skills, whether it's service or whether it's compassion or whether it's risk-taking or whether it's leadership. So it was a little harder for me to sort of pick one out, because at group night every night you were supposed to pick one, which made it a little tricky sometimes. And so I kept going back and forth between service and leadership and risk-taking. So this is what I have for Jackson. I saw God working in Jackson's life this week through service. I strongly believe Jackson's natural gift from God is service. However, several times this week, he was challenged to step up and be a leader. Jackson had the opportunity to lead our team in the kitchen, which he did well. However, it was evident that even when Jackson was appointed to serve as a leader, which challenged his risk-taking skills, his natural tendency was to fall back into a role of service, working alongside Eli, Travis, and Abigail and myself, offering help and encouragement, and of course, taking a risk and asking Eli, who was our kitchen DJ, to play Amish Paradise, which I know Eli is at least considering adding to his playlist, along with Eli's favorite, the Battle of New Orleans. Jackson, I also saw God working in your life through leadership at Possum Trot. When cutting the boards for the picnic table, Jackson had shared that he had had the opportunity to learn woodworking skills and work alongside his grandpa. Jackson used these skills to serve and help our entire group to make one of the most stable picnic tables that Mike has seen. I was able to watch Jackson serve alongside Ella while working together to measure and cut boards. Caitlin even commented on how well Jackson served our team that day using his woodworking skills. Jackson, I also got to see you take risk. I got to know you better this week and realized that another skill of his is building computers. He showed me a computer that he has been working on and proceeded to share with me how the computer worked. He also helped me to better understand what certain computer terminology meant. Seeing as Caitlin and Tony and I are currently looking for certain computers to help Caitlin at college with assistive technology. Jackson, I think that this is a risk for someone your age to say, "Hey, mom and dad, I want to try to build a computer." And Dolly and Derek, good job on supporting him in that. But to step up and say, "Hey, this is something that I think I might like and something that I want to try." And I think that'll serve you well in life. And don't ever be afraid to step out and say, "Hey, I want to do this." I also saw compassion. At the VBS at the park, when Jackson took the time to try and engage another boy whose name was also Jackson, Jackson, you show compassion when trying to show interest in his life. And I just want to close this out with a verse. It says in Matthew 5:16, in the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. So Jackson, whatever you do, whether it's going off to Lake James this week, I want to encourage you to take a risk and just to step up and to be a leader in the cabin that you're in with the boys that you're around. And I want you to not be hindered by your age, but to grow. And I think your natural tendency, like I said, is service. But in your service, I want you to step out and take risks to be able to serve other people. Okay, Misty's next.
Thank you. The two students on my team were Elsa and Caitlin. And Caitlin made a joke about only receiving blue risk-taking beads. She's joking because that's what she does. She makes light of a lot of challenging situations that she's in, and that is a strength. That is a strength of hers. I've always believed if you don't laugh, you'll cry. And so I would just like to continue to encourage you to keep taking those risks. When we first arrived at the church and we first arrived, got off the bus, and they led us down, led us up to the church and then up to our rooms, we had a very steep incline to walk down from the parking lot. We had a smaller grade, but a longer walk to up some pavement. And then we had no less than 80 stairs to walk up to get to our bedrooms where we would be staying. And so immediately I had Caitlin in mind and what a challenge this would be for her. But they decided to still come after our reports of those conditions and some modifications to where she and Nicole would sleep. And they made the decision, the risk, to still come and drive 5-6 hours to get there. And then when she got there and all of that was taken care of, it looked like this was going to be great for Caitlin. And then Caitlin was on the site at the camp for no more than 20 minutes, and she wiped out in the mud. And I'm sorry. And she was targeted by their working dogs as somebody that they needed to shepherd and help. And so it was a constant struggle for her in that first probably hour she was there at the camp. And but she got right up, and she continued on to continue serving. And this is very difficult for somebody who has faced, it shouldn't be as difficult as it would be for you and I to face those things, but it's not for Caitlin, because Caitlin has overcome many obstacles and has done that through the leadership of her parents and through relying on God and through continuing to take risks. Anytime it rains, that's a huge risk for Caitlin and for the slick nature, for her stability. And so something as simple as that, she has to endure that all the time. And so she was able to take that and come on this trip. She was able to serve others. You'll see her in pictures, still using the saw, still doing everything that every last one of us did, while it was a much big, grammar is hard after a week long away like this. But while that was very difficult at times for her, she continued, she did it. She encouraged others around her. I saw God working through her, not only in risk-taking, but in leadership. We need to see that. We need to see each other struggle and overcome in order to be good leaders. And again, that's another premise of Leader Treks. We need that as leaders in the church. We need to endure struggles together and continue to encourage each other. And that's what I saw through Caitlin this week. And so Caitlin, the verse of the day yesterday on the Crossway Bible app was Isaiah 43, verse 2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. I wanted to give that to you today, just as a reminder of our VBS theme, and that God will always be with you when you leave for Indiana Wesleyan this fall, and for the rest of your spiritual walk with God and the rest of your journey, he will be with you. The other student on my team was Elsa. Elsa came along as one of our younger students. So Mike and Kelly from the camp shared with us once in a while that, you know, you can see natural leaders just rise as you step back. And that's what we saw. And you've heard about Brooke and Abigail. And we saw that so strongly with Ella and Lily's leadership on the trails. We saw that through Ella and her leading us in worship several times throughout the week. But for our younger individuals, one thing that Leader Trek tries to remind us is that leadership development is a process. And so we got to see that start in so many of our younger students. And Elsa, I saw that with you in watching you open up to your teammates and to the rest of your friends here and allow us to lead you and them to lead you. And I saw you sharing at Bible study time. I saw you as... I saw God working in you through a lot of maturity when some of the questioning from our leaders was tough. I saw you being able to say, you know what, this is a lot more than I've ever thought about before. And so that takes real maturity and bravery and leadership to show your teammates that, you know what, you're not always going to have the answer. You're not always going to be able to answer tough questions. When you are able to do those, it will only be through God and through his leadership, through what he will do to lead you. I'd like to share a verse with you from Isaiah as well. I love Isaiah. Isaiah 49:11. No, it's not. I will uphold you with my right hand. That verse from Isaiah, I'm sorry. Sometimes it's okay to fail and make a fool of yourself, and with a mic in front of the church, it's okay. But I want to remind you that we hear in Isaiah over and over that God will be with you when you walk through the fire. He will uphold you with his right hand when you face tough times and when you face uncertainty, which is what I think that you faced a lot this week. And just being willing to step out there, I saw leadership. I saw compassion when working with children. And I just want to thank you for that example. And again, I want to thank the church who participated in the fundraising initiatives that Andrew instituted over the last few months. I'd like to thank, we had some very generous donors through that. And just thank you for that opportunity and investing in the youth group here at Warren Church of Christ, because they are the future of Warren Church of Christ. And we thank you.
All right, so on my team this week were Ella and Evan. And Ella, I saw God working in your life this week through leadership and risk-taking just because of the way that you kind of composed yourself this week, whether it was in the kitchen or helping out with VBS or leading worship. It was really cool to see you step out and, believe it or not, talk. It was kind of cool to just kind of, I mean, there was one, the first night, we were passing the books around, and I saw him coming around the other way, and I went to hand one to Ella, and I pulled it back, and she tried to slap me with it. So, it was okay. She didn't hit me with it. So, yeah, it was really cool just to kind of see her come out of her shell this week. It was kind of cool to just watch, because I, during the team times and stuff, I didn't really talk much because I just wanted to kind of see how the kids would respond. So And it was really cool just to watch all of you guys just grow in leadership, especially you, Ella, in the kitchen, just kind of taking charge, whether it was doing the dishes or cooking or whatever else needed to be done. She was just always telling us what to do, and she was the leader for that day. And then Evan, also risk-taking. There was one day where we were like, we need to make some brownies. And Ella was like, hey, Evan, do you want to make brownies? And he was like, not really. But he did it. He figured it out. And I will say, they were probably the best brownies we had all week. He followed the directions to a T. He did a really good job. And you guys all saw there was a picture of him holding the brownies. Those are the brownies that he made. And also, with your leadership, buddy, you took charge when you were leading in the kitchen. Same as Ella, kind of telling us what needed to be done, whether it was like giving me instructions to take out the trash or sweep the floor. That was, for some reason, those were mostly my jobs in the kitchen when we were cleaning up. We're sweeping the floor or taking out the trash, but that's okay. You guys were doing other stuff. But yeah, it was, like I said, it was really cool to see all of you guys continue to grow in your leadership, continue to grow in your compassion, continue to grow in your risk-taking and your service. And before we close out this morning, I would just like to echo what everybody else has said. Thank you guys for making this trip possible, because without you guys, we wouldn't have had the money to go, the prayers that we needed on the way down and on the way back. Just thank you. Thank you from everybody. And so before I give up the microphone, I guess, I'm going to pray, and then we'll have our praise team come down and close us out. Father God, I thank you just for this awesome week that we had serving you down in Kentucky. And I just pray that you would just continue to show us what it's like to serve you, whether it's here in Warren or whether it's somewhere else in the world or the United States, Father God. We just pray that you would just give us the opportunities to serve, give us the opportunities to reach people for you, and just continue to help us to be that light to this lost world. And again, just thank you just for everything that you've given us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Please stand and join us.
Hurt.
for joining us today, and have a wonderful Sunday.